I got some lobster tails. I'll check you. How fancy.
In her cute little wrap hat or whatever that thing is, after she gets done doing the business of the door. Well, anyway, we'll leave her there. That's Jennerkey, Deacon Jennerkey of the Secret Council of Society Deacons. My name is Tom Miller. I'm a member of the Secret Council of Society Deacons. Thank you. And James Wesson, the Renegade Deacon, is not here. What a surprise. But you know,
he's in our hearts.
But you know he'll make a radical appearance. Ladies and gentlemen, the Minister of the Interior. Hey, that's you, Minister. Can you get the Minister of the Interior in here? The best dressed of all the deacons, Mike Garvin. Give him a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. We do not have Father O'Brien here, our resident exorcist. He may make an appearance later, which leaves me only then to introduce our spiritual leader to the stage, the one and only Reverend Angel Dust.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Jen!
Reverend!
Bless everyone.
Reverend, do we have a quorum?
Yes.
Excellent. Let's move on with the business at hand. Number one, there is no talking during the meeting.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you.
I was telling Jen a few rules.
There's no talking here.
Sorry.
Thank you. All right, call to order. This meeting is called to order. Did that. Good. Introduction of the Senior Clergy Minister of the Interior Reverend did that. Church business. On November 4th, our director of the AA meetings, Nicole Hamilton, my professor in acting too at the University of Florida, incredible actor, and also the leader of our AA meetings, Artists Anonymous Meetings, will be taking over the show on November 4th for an all-gay theme night.
I'll stay home
then.
The next announcement.
Gays.
Status update. Apparently, we are going to have an article, not in the Alligator, but in one of the major campus newspapers. More on that as it develops. Thank you.
Hallelujah. The goddess is good.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have been so burned out. I haven't slept in a few days. I've been drinking more than ever, which is why I'm getting perfect scores on all of my college papers. And it occurred to me that when you're as fucked up as I am, and about ready to collapse or go into the fetal position or freak out, what you do is you accept the offer to take the lead role in the Christmas play at the Acrosstown Repertory Theater. May I introduce you to a new kind of contemporary Bob Cratchit. Thank you, I'm fucking insane. Moving on. Pull the tampon. Oh, now come on! All right, and now we go to individual comments from the deacons. You have, we've got to shorten it up today, a minute, 30 seconds. What part of no talking does your mouth not understand? I thought that was pretty good. Ladies and gentlemen, Deacon Jennerkey, you have a minute and a half. Go.
I just want to start with an announcement that I broke the coffee pot. There's no coffee.
Sorry, Bill Perry isn't here, so.
Yeah, okay, I've got a story, a good story about a sandwich to tell you.
Alright, story about a sandwich, go!
So today this lady came up to me in the parking lot and she was like, I'm hungry, I'm diabetic, I need a hot sandwich. And I was like, I don't have any money, but I have my card, I'll go get you a sandwich if you want. She's like, alright. I'm like, you sure you're going to be here in like 15 minutes? And she's like, yeah. Make it a hot sandwich. I was like, any dietary restrictions? Maybe you're gluten free? No. But, and I came back out. No lady. And I looked all over her. I couldn't find the lady, and I had her sandwich. And I just got really vigilant about it, and I started to just want to, like, anger feed people, you know? Just like, I'm gonna shove this sandwich in the face of a hungry person!
Excellent. This is the church that will shove food into your mouth if you just show the fuck up. Ladies and gentlemen, next on the list, announcements from Deacon Daniel Timothy Ballard. Go, minute and a half.
Have any announcements, but I was wondering, when you pull that tampon out of your ass, will confetti fly out?
That's really funny, Ballard.
Also, hey, Randy, that's my favorite video game, but I play Far of all time. Fucking rocks.
Mark Garcia playing the good game.
Thanks, that's all we got to say.
Excellent, excellent, thank you.
For those that don't know, and I'm talking to Robert now, all of the deacons are ordained under the Universal Life Church. And I want you all to know that the Universal Life Church has two tenets. Number one, only do that which is right. And number two, do not infringe upon the rights of others. Good church. It's a good church. Ladies and gentlemen, a minute and a half, the Minister of the Interior, Michael Garvin.
Very briefly, we have the last poster. We have the last poster of this bunch. It's going to sliding scale 5 to 10, $20, 5 to 20, anybody? There's a caricature of Tom Miller and also the Reverend up there. Thank you, Dan.
Hand-drawn.
This is the official image.
He used his ambience.
Anybody, $5 to $20?
I'll do a $5.
Okay, we'll do $5. Thank you.
$5.
We signed it as well.
We'll be happy to sign that for you, and if Deacon Wesson gets here, you'll have a signature from everybody. All right, ladies and gentlemen.
Hallelujah.
With a vote of the council, I'd like to give the Reverend 2 minutes. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Jennerky? Aye. Nay. Jennerky?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. 2 minutes. The Reverend Angel Dust.
Hallelujah. I have been talking with Brother David Feldman on the internet, on Facebook, and he has told me that he has in his possession 5,000 petitions, which he intends to get signed by offering professional petition gatherers $1 per signature. And he wants to have fundraisers here at 1982.
Brilliant.
He is having one.
Saturday the 26th.
October 26th or November 26th? October 26th!
Oh, isn't that amazing?
This is not a joke. It is happening. This is reality. Hemp is going to be legalized for medicine. For energy, we can put the hemp into the biomass plant and get electricity. Furthermore, we can grow it in all of these fallow fields all around Gainesville that used to grow corn and vegetables before it was profitable to grow them in Central America.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So we can resurrect agriculture in Alachua County. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And hemp can also be used for food. You can eat it.
It's delicious in brownies.
Hemp butter. And you can also use it recreationally. That's in the purple state.
Yes. You can make a suppository out of it. That's how I roll.
So visualize Florida not as a light green state, not as a dark green state, but a purple state.
Yes!
Hallelujah! Where it is fully legal and taxable. Hallelujah. Raise taxes from growing hemp. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And of course, the Tabernacle of Hedonism.
Oh, strap on your three-way safety belt for this announcement.
Has the official t-shirt.
What? T-shirts? No, that's impossible.
Yes. Official t-shirt. We have to get at least $12 for these.
You gotta show it better.
Yeah. All right, hold it up, hold it up. There you go.
Look at the bottle.
Right next to the bottle. How much is it?
$12 to $20 on the slice.
$20 on a sliding stick.
Let's sell one. 12 to 20. We'll go with 12. Who wants a t-shirt?
Do you want...
It's a t-shirt. There's a little
cannabis
t-shirt.
To be legalized in Florida.
I think we have all sizes.
We need to publicize the issue. And this is a
you
want to
get one? Are you going to get one? $12? It all goes to a good cause. More t-shirts.
More t-shirts.
Also, we're making our own Bible, so that's going to cost some money.
I also have two blank petitions.
Nice.
If you want to sign a petition. Also, if you want to make money by actually signing people up, you can talk to me about that, too.
All right, we'll go with that. We'll see if anybody wants to buy one. I'd love to sell a shirt or two before the end of the night, ladies and gentlemen. How about it for the Reverend Angel Dust? Give him a round of applause. We'll be back with the sermon. Remember, this is not the show. We have not started the show yet. The show's a whole different ballgame. Ladies and gentlemen, the renegade Deacon Wesson has actually arrived. He has informed me. Shh. Thank you. He has informed me that he would like his 2 minutes of commentary to be in the form of questions and answers from the audience. And so without further ado, please welcome to the stage Deacon Wesson, the Renegade Deacon. Deacon Wesson. Stop your fucking talking, you assholes! Now, who has a question? Yes, in the back.
Where have you been?
Good question.
Right here.
Excellent answer. Next.
That's true. He's
any been, other questions?
He's been here before.
I've been here every week since this started, except when I was in exile. I didn't have anywhere to stay, so I left. I was gone like 3 times.
That was when that Manus fucker got you, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I died.
Yes!
But I came
that's
back.
Far.
What is the secret to your beautiful beard?
Wow, that's an excellent question.
Well...
I let it grow.
I eat, yeah, I try to eat, a lot of protein, just because it's delicious. And then kale and spinach, because that covers pretty much the rest of what you need.
Do you shampoo it? Good question.
Typically. I have this method where you just get some shampoo and you start on top.
I got that
and
too.
And you just work your way down. You just get a lather on it and you just start bringing it down into the beardal regions and you get, just anywhere else. Just work your way down. And,
do you do pubic too?
Yeah, pretty much. Just anywhere where there's hair, you gotta hit that up because stuff will accumulate, in this region. So you just, start where there's the most hair and just bring the sides down, just all the way. and then you know, you guys know how to shower. You got five key areas.
Perfect answer the question. Perfectly,
cleanly,
perfectly and cleanly.
Yes.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Yes.
How do you feel about an overabundance of soy in one's diet and like the soy market in general, and the future of America as it regards like processed foods? Like, do you think we're just going to be mostly processed foods in the future, or something like that?
Excellent question.
I see a revolution happening against processed foods. So I think I'm optimistic that they'll decline. I think people will, you know, learn to stick to the edges of the supermarket or avoid the place altogether eventually. Once there's more awareness, I think the situation will get better. And I think that'll happen because I think the internet is helping the turn the tide of the information war. And as far as just soybeans specifically, you know, of course Americans eat more soy than the Japanese do, but it's in, you know, all these, you know, relatively new forms that haven't really existed in the past, like, what, you know, soy protein isolates and, you know, soy lecithin, and mostly soybean oil. That's the biggest source of soy in the diet. I don't know what those do, and nobody does, and it's probably bad, but I think the traditional methods of processing soy are totally, you know, healthy and delicious foods, such as tofu and tempeh. Those have been around for thousands of years, so. And those people aren't dead. Well, they are. The people that invented those are dead, but they lived as long as they were supposed to. The Indonesians and the Japanese are probably, you know, they're healthier than we are, so I think we should eat their foods. That's why I eat like French cheese, because of the French paradox. I just import the health directly from that country, you know.
Can you get actual real brie, though? Because I heard that you can't actually get real brie in this country.
I don't know. It's the stuff. I mean,
we'll look into that. The question was that attorney already spoke.
Yeah. Oh,
I'm sorry. Final question was at the bar over there.
I enjoy soft ripened cheeses, regardless.
Soft ripened cheeses, everybody.
Yeah.
Yes.
Cheeses.
Well, I can't hear the question.
Oh, yapping!
I was wondering about the future of cars. How do you feel that cars would be evolving over their given period from a car to
what's going to happen with cars?
The future of cars is probably small engines and series hybrids, like the dude that made created a series hybrid with a lawnmower engines, incredibly efficient. I think we'll see things like there's a thing called the Elf that's a hybrid human power and electric vehicle that you can plug in. Also use solar power, also use your own power, stuff like that. I think we'll see more hybrids. Huh?
How do you use your own power?
With pedals, usually. So there's this thing called the Elf. It's cool. Look into that. So I think, like, we'll see kind of stuff like smaller things for personal transportation.
20 seconds.
Like that. Anyway, so basically, and diesel engines are going to be very important because we can produce sustainable biodiesel. Not the way we're producing it right now, most of it, but it can be done, if it's done on a smaller, you know, I think artisanal fuel is an emerging market, believe it or not.
Ladies and gentlemen, Deacon! Very informative. Yes, this is the show that also informs. Remember, that was not the show, that was just the meeting. At this point, I think we will call the meeting to a close. Ladies and gentlemen, don't go away. The Tabernacle of Hedonism is up next. October 21st at 1982, Midtown, Gainesville, Florida, home of the Fighting Gators and the Brain Institute. We'll be right back. Music. Right on cue. And thank you very much, and we'll be right back after this. Go, Wesson. He
green.
I'm gonna go there. another mixtape. I'm sick and tired of taking drugs and staying up late. I never too late. I'm always wrong. So let go, don't you please keep in touch, I'll be running alone. I wanna be straight. 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 I wanna be straight.
Hallelujah.
Loincloth upon the bong.
In the Shadow of the Valley of Death, Possums 23, 4, verse 4, should be optional. Hallelujah. Stay away from deep alcohol. Luke chapter 21, verse 34, take heed lest any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness. And in the Tabernacle of Hedonism, we like to surfeit naked.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'll drink to that.
Whether it is in the ocean, or on the internet, or in your kitchen, or just on your living room with a picture of the ocean in behind you. Surfeit naked every day. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But although nudity is not luinity and encouraged, this does not mean that you can go on the internet and look at pictures of naked teenagers.
Oh, come on!
Only the NSA can do that. Hallelujah. And that may change soon. All sustenance cometh from the dumpster. Jamba Inn. Jamba. You can find anything you need in the dumpster. Reverend Angel does CDs. Reverend Angel does t-shirts. Reverend Angel does posters. Your favorite medicinal. Gainesville Kush. Micanopy Madness. Petitions for the constitutional amendment petition form for the use of marijuana for certain medical conditions. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Including depression with the state government. Hallelujah. And as you know, you are all innocent of sin. Why?
Why?
Because Jesus died for your drug deals.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Jesus was the kingpin. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
When the police people come to your living room to break up a domestic argument or to investigate a break-in or just to look into the fire next door and they see marijuana on the coffee table, tell them, I know who the kingpin is. It was Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And by surrendering to the goddess, you know that Jesus died for your drug deals and you will be vindicated thereof. So rat on Jesus, he is the kingpin. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Our mother.
Our mother.
Who growest art in heaven.
Growest art in heaven.
Under the influence.
Under the influence.
Of the domestic that they trim up there.
Of the domestic that they trim up there.
And mellow is that domestic herb.
And mellow is that domestic herb.
Jamba, the great dumpster goddess, is she ever high?
Jamba, the great dumpster goddess, is she ever high?
Officer Friendly, please forgive us.
Officer Friendly, please forgive us.
If we were driving 2 miles an hour below the minimum on I-75.
If we were driving 2 miles below the minimum on I-75.
And if she finds anything suspicious.
And if she finds anything suspicious.
We
of how it got there. For knowing is the cow pie.
For knowing is the cow pie.
The ring.
The ring.
And the shroom.
And the shroom.
Amen.
Amen.
A woman.
A woman.
A joint.
A joint.
A liquid sunshine.
A liquid sunshine.
Goddess, bless them. Hallelujah. And thank you for coming to church.
We always play a country ballad when the Reverend Angel Dust has finished his sermon. Yes, Reverend.
Have you made your contribution to the Tabernacle of Hedonism?
I think I have.
Well, then you can have this beer.
Oh, bless you. Thank you.
Because the goddess has forgiven you because you made a contribution.
Is this Jumba's dumpster beer?
No, it is just beer. you can drink it because you made a contribution.
Thank you. That means a lot. It's not easy to drink in church and not be sinning, and I'm the guy to do it. Ladies and gentlemen, our next entertainer is fantastic. He's a regular here. I really like him a lot, and I think you will too. He does comedy all over town. He's very well known. Please welcome to the stage, Ishmael Lutfi. Give him a round of applause.
From Tom Miller?
Yeah.
You're a hero of Gainesville. Hey, how you doing? 1982.
Great.
Have an evening.
Hey.
Alright.
How about it for Ishmael, everybody? Give him a round of applause. Awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, etc. Hey, George. How you doing? What a beard you've got. Can you come up and show it off? Hey, guys, check this out. This is a beard. I mean, it's no James Wesson beard, but look at it. Look at the attitude of it. Reverend Angel Dust, if I may give you the big book. Thank you. All right. Can I get everyone's attention, please? I know it's possible. I just.
Why? It's creepy.
Thank you. Our next guest has never been to the Tabernacle. We love newbies. I would like you all to listen to him because he's going to do something so remarkable that human beings don't have the attention span to pay attention to it, which is the thing that creates humanity's culture, the very reason that we're alive, and that is to listen to a fucking story. That this is no ordinary storyteller. Please welcome to the stage, Pablo. Give him a round of applause.
So, I've only recently moved to the United States, and I'm currently living in New York City. And it's a strange thing to move to the United States, because I lost the ultimate superpower that a person can have, and it's that I'm no longer considered white.
Aww.
I am now a Latin American. In Guatemala, I am considered white. And that is very strange. Now I have to worry about cops and all these other things. But that's not what I'm here to talk to you about. I'm actually going to tell you a story about something that I experienced a few years ago. See, I am a field biologist.
Cool.
So basically, what I do is I go to a certain area and I try to find a certain number of certain organisms, and then I figure out how many there are, and then I get wasted, and then I go back and do that again the next day. And this is basically the life of a field biologist. Now, what's interesting about being a field biologist is that it takes you to very strange, very remote locations. And so once I was studying a certain type of bird, and I ended up in a small border town in southeastern Guatemala. Now, I know that most people don't know where Guatemala is. It's a small country to the southeast of Mexico. And it's somewhere between the Middle Ages and the post-apocalypse. It's a very strange place. And so I was supposed to go to this mountain and find this bird. And for this purpose, I was contacting some locals. And they said to me, well, okay, you can come down and do this, but before you come, it is very important that you send to us a picture of yourself and also the make and model of your car. And when you come into town, if your windows are blacked out, they should be rolled down. And this, of course, struck me as very strange. So, but you know, I figured, you know, what the hell, gotta do what the locals say, so I decided to cooperate. And I did all those things. And then I started driving. Now, southeastern Guatemala is not what most people would expect. It's not this lush tropical thing that most people imagine when they think of a tropical country. It's actually a very dry, arid valley with a huge cowboy culture. So what you see there is a lot of hats and guns and boots and stuff like that. So I drove for a few hours, and I start pulling into this town, and I get on the main road, and as soon as I hit the main road, I find that it's blocked. I cannot drive down the main street of this town, because there are two pieces of wood and a chain between them. And behind that, there is a guy with a hat and some boots, and he has two guns strapped on his belt. And he says, the main street is closed, you cannot go through. And I thought that was odd. So, you know, whenever you address someone with a gun, you speak a little bit more respectfully. So I asked him, so what's going on? And he says, well, it's Don Fernando's daughter's birthday party. And I thought, well, that's odd. So what should I do? So he directs me and tells me how to go roundabout way. And it turns out that these people, it turns out that Don Fernando is kind of the drug lord that basically owns this town. So the entire main street has been closed off, and they've got all these bands, and they've got food and alcohol for everyone. So I just go up to the people that I was meeting, and I tell them, well, what's going on? And they explained to me that, you know, there's bands coming in, there's music, there's food, there's everything, and pretty much everyone in town is invited, and that if I want to go, then I should go. And I tell them, well, do you think it's okay? Do you think I'll be welcome? And they said, yes, but we don't advise that you go. And I said, well, why? Isn't everyone welcome? He said, yeah, but, you know, last month we had the town fair, kind of a festival. Every town in Guatemala has a patron saint. And on the day of that saint, there's a big party, sort of. And he said, well, last time we had the fair, there was an incident. And of course, this is like a sweet old lady telling me this in the most casual way possible. And I tell her, what kind of incident? And she says, well, there was a guy who was dancing with a girl. And then it turned out that this girl was the girlfriend of a local police officer. So the police officer did not approve of this other guy dancing with her. So he went back and got his gun and killed the guy and injured three other people. And then the other people retaliated. And at some point, we just had the army come in and just like lock down the entire town. So now everyone's just kind of, you know, keeping it low key. You know, I felt somewhat shocked. So I did the only reasonable thing I could do, which was to, you know, put on my nicest shirt and go to the party. And then, you know, I find myself there and I'm having a great time. There's beer, there's food, and I'm an outsider. And the word gets out that there is a gringo that has come to town. And of course, I'm not a gringo, but it turns out that who I am changes a lot, depending on where I am. You know, in rural Guatemala, I'm a white guy. In like the capital city of Guatemala, I'm kind of a mix of things. In the United States, I'm, I don't know, some kind of immigrant. So it's just like, but I go there, and the rumor gets out that I am a gringo. So, you know, I always tell people that Guatemala is a country of 14 million people that don't want to live there. So, and the easiest way out, of course, is to marry a foreigner. So I'm in this place, I'm having fun, I'm having a great time, and all the young, eligible females of the town decide that, you know, they should try to flirt with a gringo. So I'm there, and I'm surrounded by this bunch of 14-year-old girls. Which, you know, makes me uncomfortable for various reasons. Particularly because, you know, I was just told the story of the guy that got shot for dancing with a girl. And I cannot deal with this. I'm drunk, of course, because, you know, you kind of can't be a field biologist unless you're kind of a drunkard, too. So, the thing is that I find myself in this uncomfortable situation, and I'm picturing myself, you know, getting buried out in the desert somewhere. But it turns out that that's wrong. I mean, they don't bury people out in the desert. That takes a lot of work, you know. You gotta get people, get shovels, dig a hole. You know, it's a lot of work. So actually, what I learned was that these people that run the town, what they do is they keep exotic pets, like crocodiles and lions. And so, you know, I guess that maybe it would have been more useful than just being in a hole. But I don't want to be there. So the thing is that I walk out, you know, I leave, and I start doing something else. So the next day, this has passed, you know, everything's kind of quiet, and I decide to explore the town a little bit more. So I drive into the town, and I find, you know, whenever I'm in a new town, what I do is I try to go to the very center of the town. There's usually a park there, probably a church, probably some important buildings. So I go there, and, you know, it's like, there's indeed a little park about the size of this stage, actually. And then, other than the park, there is a little convenience store where you can also rent the phone, so if you need to make phone calls, you can do it from there. And there is a gun shop, and then a car wash. This just like insane state of the art car wash, which later on I found out is used to launder money. And I'm walking around the park, so I'm doing this, you know. And there's this guy there sitting with a table and an umbrella. And I'm wondering what he's doing there. So I just ask him, so, you know, what do you do here? Why do you hang out at the park all day? He tells me, oh, I'm a writer. I say, well, this is interesting. This is not something I expected to encounter here. And I ask him, so what kind of writing do you do? And he says, well, I write letters. You know, like people come to me and I charge 5 cents per word and I write letters. Because as it turns out, you know, he's like the one guy that knows how to read. So that's how he makes his living. And that's kind of, you know, I thought that was interesting. And of course, what I'm looking for is a place to drink. And there is one spot, there's one place in this entire town where you can drink. So I go in there, and, you know, I'm ordering beers, you know, the one variety of beer that is available. And then suddenly, these two guys walk in. and you know what they're about. You know, they're wearing their big hats. They've got their shirts buttoned down to here, big gold chain, cowboy boots, big belt buckle, and of course they've got their guns, which have been dipped in gold, which, you know, makes them a little bit more showy. And the guns have extended clips. And everyone in there is just kind of paying attention to what they're up to, you know? So the guy walks in, these two guys walk in, and there's one guy who's like clearly the boss. He's the man in charge. The other guy is just taking orders. And he sits down, orders a beer, pulls out a pack of cigarettes, and he opens it, and he finds that they're all gone. So I know that, you know, I gotta be nice to these guys, so I take out my own cigarettes and I say, hey, would you like one of mine? And he says, no, don't worry. So he goes outside and there's a police car parked right there. And the guy says to the cop, hey, why don't you go down to the store and get me a pack of cigarettes? And the cop just very briskly, you know, and it's this, the cop's just like this skinny dude, you know, that you can tell he's like powerless, you know, and he gets in his squad car and runs down to the corner store and gets this guy a pack of cigarettes. And right then and there, I understood very clearly where this whole issue that we call the drug war is going, you know? It's like the Black Knight in that Monty Python movie, you know? It's it's a lost cause. So the guy does that, and he runs back, gives the boss his pack of cigarettes, and I'm just in awe, you know? I cannot believe it. But, you know, after a while, I adapt to just that, the social dynamics of the place. And you kind of learn your place in those areas. And you can kind of get by. But the most interesting thing that I experienced while I was in this small town was at one point, the leader of this family that has, you know, the cops, like, drink cigarettes for them and all, the guy dies. You know, the guy has a heart attack and he dies. So, of course, again, there's a huge festival and everyone's invited. And it's like, there's of course a funeral march. And you see, again, the streets are blocked off. And it's just a parade with a gigantic horse at the front. And there's a driver. And there's various smaller horses behind this. And these are all like very expensive Spanish horses. And then there's a helicopter overhead throwing rose petals. Like, this guy is the fucking king, right? So that's I don't know, I feel like I've lost you guys. But I just wanted to come up here and tell you guys my experience in this small town. I experienced several other things in other places similar to that. Another time I was in Western Guatemala, which is a totally different environment. It's very mountainous. And in these towns, you know, I feel that whenever you're in these small towns that are totally controlled by your people, what you have to look for is what is out of place, you know? I'm driving around this town. By this time, I know the protocol. I'm doing the windows roll down. I know what it's about. I feel very confident. And I'm driving around. And you know, it's all the things that you would expect from a small town in Guatemala. There's people growing corn. There's a guy with a cart and a mule just carrying his wood. I'm driving around in his rental car. And I look, and suddenly, there's a fucking castle. And then, you know, it just seems a bit odd, you know? And there's a helicopter in the front lawn, and this parade of black SUVs and guys with automatic weapons. And this castle is just like, the tackiest thing I've ever seen. It's like, imagine if you took a picture of that castle they have in Disney World, and then you hired the greatest engineer in this small town in Guatemala, and you told him, I give you $2 million in cash, just build this. And that's kind of what it looked like. And the thing is that in this town, again, same system, there is a car wash, which looks like, you know, it's from Daytona Beach. And there is a grocery store and a gun shop. And then there's a place where I was staying, which was a gas station, which of course is a convenience store attached to it, but it's also the hotel. And that's like the only entertainment in this town is that one gas station, so everyone's just coming down to hang out at this gas station. And so I'm staying there, and I'm doing what biologists do, I'm counting flies, you know, wondering if this larva would make my ramen a little bit more nutritious. And you know, every single night, I'd be in my room, and I'd look out into the gas station, and it's these guys, and they're getting drunk in the gas station, and they've got their guns, and they're shooting into the air. I'm like, that's a gas station. And these guys are shooting into the air, and I'm laying there, you know, looking at this corrugated metal roof that would probably break if it's going pebble at it. Of course, it made me a little nervous. What can you do, right? I mean, you're there. So those are things that you experience. And you know, it's interesting because you'd imagine that this is somehow rare, but no, that's kind of the norm. That's all I've got for you guys tonight. So thank you all for listening, and I'm going to turn the mic over to Tom. Real experiences, ladies and gentlemen. Give a round of applause, Pablo. First time here. Cool stuff. Very cool stuff. Now, I owe Greg Werner an apology. I'd like to do that in public, Greg. I said I was going to put you on first in the comedy circle, but I couldn't do that because I fucked up. And also because you're awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, before we bring on our main attraction, R. Garcia, who's traveled all the way here from Atlanta and is a universal musician, which you're really in for a treat, please welcome to the stage, I think, one of the funniest comedians in town, my personal favorite, Greg Werner. Give him a round of applause.
So the government is up and running again. The one good thing about the government shutdown was that there was a gag order on Biden's mouth. I had a dream, really a nightmare, that I married a cow, but I shouldn't talk about Roseanne Barr that way. And the funny thing is, the economy is so bad, I can't even afford a cow. You know, the economy is so bad that Kanye West fired his ego. I wanted to be a I thought about going into politics, but... But I couldn't I couldn't run a campaign because I didn't want to get AIDS.
Yes! Oh, yes! Awesome!
Oh my God! Incredible!
Oh my God!
And then, I'm going to do an impression now.
You're
going to
do a comedian.
I don't think I'm going to do it because I don't like it, but I'm not going to sing it, but there's this guy that sang this song, I guess it was back in the 80s, that said, you don't have to take your clothes off to have a good time. And the pathetic thing is the guy died of AIDS. Well, I'm not gay, but my cat is. Well, I think that what this happened with the government shutdown with Bonner and Obama, they should do a movie, they should do a sequel to Dumb and Dumber. When you heard of the Lone Ranger, the movie that they made, it was a flop, and so they are going to make a sequel, but they can't afford a real horse or a computer-generated animal. So a human is going to play the horse. I guess any member of Congress could play the ass. They say that in Washington, if you want a friend in Washington politics, you should get a dog. I can't say that about Obama because he would eat his dog.
Not your freezes. Probability is high.
I was here a couple of weeks ago, and I remembered someone, I was talking about how love bugs have a better sex life than me, and I thought, and someone said, I'd like to see you in my windshield. I don't know if that person is here tonight, but I wanted to say, if I'm ever that desperate, I'll just shoot myself. I've heard of Ted Cruz, the Republican from Texas. He's so retarded that he makes W look brilliant.
Gotta live.
Well, I thought I'd do another impersonation. I'll start it, you finish it. The question you gotta ask is, do you feel lucky? Well, do you, punk?
No.
Well, I guess you heard that Wiener lost. He's a primary in September. The only thing big about that man is his mouth. I know two people that are so dumb, they needed me to open a combination lock for them, and that's a true story. I mentioned they work at Walmart. I've seen some hot-looking Chinese women.
Here we go.
Talk about Mugu Gai Pan.
Hey, I know that's racist. I don't have those.
That's all I have, and thank you, and thank you, Tom.
Right now, we're taking a 5-minute break. Get a drink, go out and smoke a cigarette, but you come back here because if you don't, you missed it. We'll be right back at the Tabernacle of Hedonism.
I'm gonna
time, does anyone want to buy a t-shirt?
No. Well, I helped Charles buy it.
Thank you.
chip, 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 chip.
Traveled here
for
my birthday.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks for having us. I feel like this is going to be a great time, guys.
Yeah!
I mean, so far it's already been a great time, but I think we're going to have it turned up a little bit. When your drummer is a MacBook, you're bound to have trouble getting him to start up.
But the pay's good.
There we go.
You still have we don't have to split anything.
You still have to blow him afterwards, though.
I don't know where my guitar strap ended up.
You can't say filthy things like that in our church.
You can have a spirit.
Oh, nice.
Oh yes, you can.
So we're about to get started. I hope everybody has a nice alcoholic beverage.
Indeed.
Or non-alcoholic if you don't drink, pussies.
We run with the demon alcohol in this band.
Holy shit.
Sweet. We do things a little differently. We still dumpster dive though.
We don't do anything differently. We're basically every band you've ever met. We like to get really drunk and nail groupies.
We snort Percocets.
We do. We snort the Percocets. Stolen from only the frailest grandmothers. If your grandmother's still got life in her, we don't want that shit. I want to taste the sweet chemical taste of her demise. I took that too dark, didn't I?
No.
You know, I've had a grandmother die. It's okay. I can tell jokes like that. I know a dead grandma.
That's like I had sex with a black girl, so I'm going to tell you a black joke. What do you call a black person that flies a plane? A pilot, you fucking racists.
I think we're almost ready. Slowly. He's gotten closer and closer to the ready position. Can the record please stand that whatever that racing game is over there, I beat him several times at it. It's fun as shit. Before we came here, they had 50-cent tacos, which is basically erotic literature to me. If anybody says anything about tacos 75 cents or lower, I'm probably beating it in the bathroom. I really hope he figures this out because I'm running out of funny shit to say.
You don't have to say stuff funny here at all. Stand up.
I can just tell you guys the truth. I can tell you the truth. I'm 25, I don't have a fucking job. I'm in a band. I don't have a job. I don't need a job. I watch Netflix, that's my fucking job.
Oh. apparently our drummer wasn't such a wimp. He could be here with us to enjoy these fine, fine people.
And the fine 50-cent tacos. I'm gonna keep revisiting that because that's magical to me.
It's like you've never been to a college town. The 50-cent taco is like the cornerstone on which college educations are built.
I'm from a college town, but it's a Christian college town, so you don't get shit for free.
See?
Because that's not how you were raised.
Back when I was a young buck and I attended university in this town in the yesteryear of 1995, it used to be you could get beers for 50 cents.
It was a better time.
What happened?
A drunker time.
What happened is that nobody wanted to drink Ballard's anymore.
I'll drink Ballard's.
Ballard's, it sounds like a combination of bowels and innards.
Ballard's, you hear that?
With whoever wrote that song for how many times Gucci can be said in a song.
Did you guys hear about 2 Chainz fracturing his neck because his chain was too big?
Is that true?
I call that fucking poetic justice.
The rapper 2 Chainz received a neck fracture, which canceled part of his performance.
The irony is that it was just one chain that was so heavy.
I'm also wearing 2 Chainz.
If he had had the 2 Chainz, as his name implied, maybe we'd have been rid of him that day.
Wow.
But no luck. What? Do you guys listen to that shit?
He's hilarious.
2 Chainz?
I don't know
who
he is.
He's awesome.
Can you
tell
your vocals? Which one?
I turned it back.
Get to this side.
Speakers are going that way. Remove yourself from the fortress of solitude and sit with the rest of the people.
You tell her. Yeah.
God forbid.
God forbid.
I'm gonna let my bass guitar take a nap.
Thank you.
playing if you come here ever to play video games.
Yes.
Yeah. Stay away from the water.
Majora's Mask is the best. He's never played it.
That doesn't mean I don't care.
He's like, I would love the Zelda games. They're my favorite games. But he's never played Majora's Mask.
Oh, I'm sorry. I've only beaten like 8 of the titles. I mean, come on.
Take off the training wheels.
Right?
I didn't know this was going to be an intervention.
Condoms inside for your pleasure and protection. So if you would just grab one or two of those, check out our music online, randygarcia.com or rgarcia.com or whatever, and we're on the Facebook, r_Garcia.
It's rgarcia.org, actually.
.org, he's an organization.
Because we don't make any money, is this?
What's your MySpace?
It's probably RG.
MySpace is dead, dude.
I got one at one point.
We'll be right back.
guys.
Just two more!
Okay, fine. Eight more, but only because you begged.
Yes!
Hospital. I don't remember what it was called. I moved to Cleveland, Tennessee in the first grade. Little did I know those were to be dark times.
Orlando promotes rhythm control.
Amazing.
Yes.
Hey, Art Garcia continues to tour. The greatest way that you can honor them is to check their stuff out. Drop them a couple of bucks. They need gas. They're going back to Atlanta. Check their stuff out. There's really cool merch. Better merch than I ever had. Or get a beer or whatever it takes. Survived. Please join us in the center area, if you will. Bring your beverages over. Bring me one. We're going to have a cathartic moment here. I want to do this. If you don't do this for me, I quit the show.
Congratulations.
Thank you. It means a lot. Yes, buy their merch. It's good merch. Art Garcia has never made an issue out of getting the material, but if you've got some money, that would be cool too. Real cool. Plus there's condoms. Think of the fun you could have after church. Thank you. I don't want to hear that song. I don't think I like that song. All right. Hold on. We've got one more thing, ladies and gentlemen. Come around, collect around, let's do a little campfire deal. You guys with me? Alright, let me try it like this. If you're buying merch or drinking, stay. If you're talking, leave. Unless you're talking about good things. Otherwise, join me at the resolution. This is the denouement! Denouement!
Hey, Marlon Brando. Get the cotton balls.
I do not understand the meaning of the word punishment. You and your virtue, Robespierre. You take no bribes, run up no debts, sleep with no women. Always wear a clean coat and never get drunk. Robespierre, you are abominably virtuous. I'd be disgusted if for 30 years I wore that same self-righteous look stuck on my face, running about between heaven and earth, if only for the miserable pleasure of finding someone worse than myself.
Like me?
Is there nothing in you, not the merest whisper, that says to you very softly and very secretly, you lie. You lie. Conscience is an ape tormenting himself before a mirror. Yes, we all dress up in our high morals and go out on the town to Club 1982 to get the good time we want. Why get in each other's hair about it? I say each man to his own pleasure and the right to defend himself against any who threaten it. But you, have you the right to turn the guillotine into a tub? To wash people's dirty laundry with their severed heads for scouring stones? And all because you like to wear a clean coat? Yes, if they spit on it or tear holes in it, defend yourself. But what business is it of yours so long as they have you in peace? If people are happy going about the town in dirty laundry, have you the right to slam them into their graves? Are you the policeman of heaven?
If you and your supreme being don't like it, hold a handkerchief to your nose.
Here, I dredged up some old poetry tonight off of my Google Drive. Yeah. So this first piece is called Dreamweaver. Shh. I've given you many words, and I know I've committed perjury, plagiarism, fabrication, shall we say? Know that I cannot weave for you. I live in speculation. I dream of fictionalization. I talk in narration. I love in consummation. I cry in damnation. I hurt in duplication. I lead in dictation. And I lust in elevation, but I think in confirmation. Cannot apologize, not for undeserving. If I could talk to you, what would I say? Probably ask you how you are. I write in frustration. Who do you know? Changed. Cannot always tell you what I am. Has my pattern changed? Well, has your needle strayed? Remember who I am. I am a former and a future. This next piece is called Untitled. It's not called Untitled, it is Untitled, because sometimes titles are ridiculous. It's not enough to love. It's not enough to try. It's not enough to fight. At the end of the day, I must be alone. Pointless gestures of affection lose to affirming mouse clicks. And usury and the casting of buddies on fucking Facebook. I'm too exhausting for them. It's too exhausting for me. So I'm no one's friend. I know you don't like me like I like you. I know you don't love me like I love you. I know my love falls back on me. When every effort I make is too much, I really am not your friend. So I guess we can't hang out like I'd like to, like we used to. I know I'm the odd one out. And even though you matter so much, I really am not your friend. Forgive me for whatever I've done. I've done trying to find someone. For years, I felt messed up inside, like all I do makes them hide. What do I have to do to make you people happy? Am I a part of anyone's whole? Do I have any place in your soul? What can I do to make this love sound? This heart goes wasted on the people I'm around because I'm no one's friend. And this last piece I just wrote earlier today, these other pieces were from 2007, 8? Yeah, years ago. Anyway, this is called Woman A to Z. I may not be Artemis, but I aim my bow true. I may not be Buffy, but I'd slay demons for you. I may not be Cleopatra, but I'd take poison for you. I may not be Diana, but I'd lasso the moon for you. I may not be Elizabeth, but I'd run a kingdom for you. I may not be Van, but I'd fly out to sea for you. I may not be Gwen Stacy, but I'd get tangled in your web. I may not be Hera, but my jealousy challenges the gods. I may not be Isis, but I'd bring you back to life. I may not be Joan of Arc, but my faith is strong. I may not be Kali, but I destroy a world for you. I may not be Lola, but I'm still a vixen by night. I may not be Madonna, but I'll make you feel like a virgin. I may not be Nina, but I'd let you drain my blood. I may not be Persephone, but I'd go to hell for you. I may not be Candisa, but I'd fuck your brains out. I may not be Rhiannon, but I'll send all the king's horses for you. I may not be Sabrina, but I'll put a spell on you. I may not be Teresa, but I'll pursue peace above all else. I may not be Ushas, but I'll bring the light to you. I may not be Vanessa, but I'll unfold my wings for you. I may not be Xena, but I could still kick your ass. I may not be Yamuna, but I take away your sin. And I may not be Ziva, but I'd bring back life to you. I am a shade of the universal woman. I'm not a simple trick. I'm a token of the goddess. I am not a 2D flick. I am an atom of the universe. I'm not an empty shell. I am a prayer for life, eternal. I am your champion, not your quell. Thank you.
And so, we have reached a moment. I would like to ask the Reverend Angel Dust if he would kindly join me on stage. Ladies and gentlemen, for those of you who came and did not survive this long, we pray for you in Ohio. And for those of you who stayed till the bitter end, we bless you with the power of Jamba. Reverend Angel Dust, I give you the last word.
Facebook and our soon to be upcoming website, blogging a prayer a day. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Telephone to heaven.
Hello?
For more dumpster dimes. Hallelujah. And pray for legalization in 2014.
Hallelujah!
2013!
2009!
Check out that stuff. Buy things.
Okay, buy things.
Buy stuff from Art Garcia. These are incredible musicians. You guys saw what you saw. They're a traveling band. Hopefully they'll be back. November, is that correct, Tyler? November?
Yeah.
November and hopefully January. Maybe back to the Tabernacle if we give them a good run.
Wow. Okay.
The first step to Jubitopia is the first step. Hallelujah. And let us be very, very grateful that the mushroom toad party and the tea party came to a resolution of their differences so that we could have socialized marijuana. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Under Obama.
Amen.
Amen.